Good evening, good evening, good evening. What a wonderful time of fellowship and hopefully new friendships and exchanging of ideas. The Food for Thought series has been a very, has had a long history at Trinity and is so exemplified this evening because Food for Thought is designed to bring not only faculty and staff and students, but also all our loved community members together to explore concepts and ideas, and that's why it's called Food for Thought. We're so delighted that you're here this evening, and so many of you were interested that we had to have two rooms. So we're sorry for the split, but we're delighted you're all here. And I know that the readers tonight are glad to know that they didn't scare you off from coming. So, I'm Kay Casey. I'm Assistant Vice President at Trinity University. I have been here a long 7 months, and every month is exciting and a great one. I'm delighted to be at Trinity. To me, I've worked at four different universities and colleges in different capacities at different times. And to me, Trinity brings together the very best of what I call higher education. It's one of your mind, your soul, your spirit, and how you will be as a citizen of the communities that you go to. The Vice President, Mike Bacon, apologizes that he's not here this evening. Tomorrow evening, we start the first ever Alumni and Parent National Conference. This year, it will be in Houston. It goes all day on Saturday on Houston, and I'm so glad that Jeannie is going to be bringing her granddaughter, I just learned, to the conference on Saturday. We're so delighted. But Mike and President Danny Anderson are both connected to the conference, and so they send their apologies for not being able to be with you this evening. This evening is going to be one that is coordinated by Tom Payton, who is head of our Trinity University Press, as well as, gosh, I'm sorry, my papers are slipping on me, Professor Jim Brown, who is also a professor in English at Trinity. Now, here we go. I wanted to thank there's two ladies who worked very hard coordinating this whole evening. And I want to hopefully extend a hand of applause to Patty Rogers Cooper and Susan Labanoff for all your hard work. Thank you for being here. Now we have some other very wonderful people who have volunteered to participate this evening, and I'm going to very quickly introduce them. Dirk Elmendorf, are you here? Raise your hand. Dirk is one of the co-founders of Rackspace. He attended Trinity University, and he's now with R26D. Did I get it right? Great. Then we also have Professor Colleen Grissom. And I want you to know that Professor Grissom has transcended the generations of alumni from Trinity University. And she is the number one person during alumni weekend that everyone wants to hear. And we thank you so much, Colleen. We also have with us Dr. Arturo Madrid, who is also emeritus. We also have two wonderful alumni Dan Malay, Mallet, whose class of 2011 and 2012, raise your hand. And Jenna Price, class of 2011. Becca McNeil, thank you. Becca's with the Rivard Report here in San Antonio. Professor Paul Myers, in computer science at Trinity University. Naomi Schuhab Nye. So, so many of our volunteers are also noted authors and poets, and that includes Naomi. Naomi's a very gifted writer. Professor David Ribble, who teaches biology and ecology. Gretchen Rush. You sat in the wrong place. Gretchen is our women's tennis coach at Trinity, and we're so glad that you're with us. And then one who everyone knows in Bear County, and I told him if he came tonight, it just means good things for him at the next election, Judge Nelson Wolf. Well, Tom Payton is going to take over the rest of this program. I just want to say a few words as Tom steps up. Tom has been in the literary business for more than 27 years. He has more than 600 new books that he has either published or promoted. And he has launched six new imprints and series. He's moved to San Antonio 7 years ago, so he's been here longer than I have. But he's made such a difference. So delighted.
So welcome, it's great to see they told me to project. It's great to see so many familiar faces and new faces. And when I was charged with or debating with Jenny how to structure this evening, I thought I got off easy when we agreed that Jenny would be really the mistress of ceremonies and work our way through each reader tonight and get us prepared for each. And then I realized, oh, I'm going to kick it off. What could I say? And I thought I'd jump up and read a poem like everyone else. And then I thought, you're going to hear plenty of poems. And then I thought, I know a bunch of you and I don't know a bunch of you. And so 27 years in the book business, I thought I would just instead try to set the tone by sharing a couple quick personal stories about me, books, why I'm here, and then hopefully that ends with why poetry and sets the stage for folks who can read poetry probably better than I. Some of you know that my business, my stint in the book business actually started in bookstores. I'm not your English major who went straight off to New York and jumped into publishing. I worked for what was then the South's largest independent chain, Oxford Books in Atlanta, rest their soul, now long gone. And I fell into this career of books after a 5-month backpacking stint in Europe. The classic, hackneyed, take off to Europe to figure out what I wanted to do with my life with undergraduate and graduate school in the rearview mirror, and still too many questions. And as I'm sure many of you are familiar with or could tell a version of the same story, I came back with more questions than I had answers. I quickly ran into a friend of mine who was a manager at Oxford Books, and right on the edge of the harried holiday season, she said, "Well, you're trying to figure out what you really want to do with your life. Come help me run my bookstore. Give me through Christmas." And I joined her as a manager at the bookstore, and I kind of never really looked back. My parents were obsessive readers, and I always grew up around books and words. I thought poetry was not in my universe, really. I've been an after-school library volunteer since 7th grade. When I wasn't playing baseball, I was just around books. And I thought that working in a bookstore would be the perfect job while I waited to figure out what I really wanted to do. Along the way, I made good use of my employee discount, read a lot, and nevertheless, it's at that moment that poetry really entered my life. Growing up, poetry books were on the shelf, sure, Dad talked about this, Mom talked about that, but it never really registered. Just a few weeks on the job, I got thrown, because our events manager at Oxford was sick, I got thrown the task of running an event that night. And it turned out to be a very big event, which we had regularly. I came to work and realized hundreds of people had been lined up outside for hours, waiting for our author that night. And I quickly realized that the words big and poetry rarely appear next to each other in the same sentence. That night, the ever-popular, not everybody's favorite, but the ever-popular Maya Angelou signed books for hours and hours and hours. She stopped to chat with every single child and teenager. Personally, she looked deep in their eyes, and she gave them as much time as they wanted or needed, often reaching over to a pad she carried with her to scribble a quote or an inspirational saying or a line from a poem that she would share with them after she asked them what they wanted to be when they grew up. I was mesmerized watching her for over 3.5 hours, even at her age then, spend time with this crowd. And then just a week later, the poet Natsuki Shange arrived to a smaller crowd, but still a pretty remarkable crowd for what was frankly Lily White Buckhead in Atlanta, Georgia. And I watched her crowd as she at one point gathered them to jump out of line and just cluster, and probably 150 people squeezed in. And she asked them to think about, while they jumped back in line and waited for a book, to think about one question for which there may or may not be an easy answer. And that was, why all the black poets seem so much busier and so much popular in February? Some people immediately got it, others scratched their head. And she engaged again in conversations, deeper, more provocative, with anyone who would engage with her. It's in those early moments, those early weeks, I realized that I had really already made my big decision in life. I was there to stay. I loved my job as much as I love it today. And that was 27 years ago. Growing up, I had a bit of an obsession with words. Sorry. Let's just flip on. Especially cliches and commonly used phrases. I often wondered about their origin or their meaning, and I questioned if people questioned the meaning. My 90-year-old, at that point, very Baptist grandmother used to refer to us as Episcopalians, blaming our religious state on having moved to the big city away from the country and our big city lifestyle, and the fact that she always reminded us that she held out hope for us. During one of my extended summer week-long vacations to the country, and designed for a city boy to learn about milking cows, putting up canned stuff, which curiously was always in glass jars and not cans, and of course the Bible, I asked Mother Payton if in Matthew it says, when two or more people are gathered in my name, I shall be among them, does it mean that when I pray alone, God's not listening? Silent. Reaching for her Bible, long stare, and as I reached for her soft peppermint candy on the counter to deflect the silence, she laughed all of a sudden and said, "Well, of course not. That's silly. God is always listening. And that's a hell of a good question, Tommy." He'd be amused. And I suddenly realized that's the only time I had heard her use the word hell, that it wasn't a geographic destination. Things seemed to have changed. I wanted to follow up by asking, if God had such a sense of humor, why didn't we find jokes in the Bible? But I knew better. Years later, as an adult, despite late-night beers and many a bar, sometimes debating God again with my friends, at one trip to the bathroom, I realized that I had never met the famed man from Nantucket, as I was beginning to realize, think about poetry in my life. And I realize now that's a good thing. We all learned that Robert Frost famously and quite confusingly wrote that two words diverge in a yellow wood, and many of my generation and yours were weaned on such turns of a phrase. I remembered my dad had proclaimed in my non-poetry young years that Frost was the best that there was, and pointed to the book on the shelf, and I assumed, of course, that was true. And while I did not know that roses are red sometimes, I continued to question where one actually finds blue violets. And I guess after all these years, I would jump back and say that for me is what is the power of poetry from a book guy's, non-poet's point of view, from the street, from a bookstore aisle, from long conversations with customers who are not trained with degrees in literature, maybe aren't armed to tell which poem's a good poem and which poem's a bad poem, quote unquote. The power of poetry is that it's structured yet streamlined and stripped down larger ideas or a single idea. Sometimes it's laid bare and raw, painful. Sometimes it's dressed back up beautifully so that we can imagine things in a different way. It's a contained emotion, poetic justice through poetic license. It welcomes everyone at any level, of any age, at any time, all comers, though you may scratch your head along the way and wonder. You have to admit, it plays in the same arena at the end of the day with meditation, prayer, and even yoga. Like poetry and poets, we should all take more time to give ourselves poetic license and our individual journeys to discover, maybe even rationalize, what and who we want to be and how we want to see the world around us. I've been fortunate to publish and poet and be involved with, publish and promote and be involved with so many wonderful poets in my career. Most recently at Trinity University Press, through the many poets we published through the former directorship of Barbara Rass with us this evening. Lest my poetic references tonight be taken as too bawdy or pedestrian, I'll close with the words of Gerald Stern, a stunning observer of everyday life, now in his 90s, having written poems for more than 70 years. We're honored to have published prose by Stern, which I'd like to share with you. And I'm sure I cannot do him justice in reading this. I believe human beings should pay very close attention to each other. They should reach out beyond the family and help the oppressed, the trapped, and the sick. They should insist on security for and from the larger society. They should pay attention to the past, live with grief, make charity personal, teach without end, share food, listen patiently to the young, and honor their music. Turn their backs on corporations, advertising, and public lying, hate liars, undermine bullies. Love June 21st, and on that day, kiss every plant and tree they see. They should love two-lane highways, old cars, and old songs. They should eat with relish and study insects. They should never stop raising children. They should fight for school teachers, pay them, give them tenure, and let them make the rules, as Coca-Cola does. They should insist that no one be paid more than 10 times anyone else, no matter what or where. They should make fun of war, flags, uniforms, weapons, pulpits, oval offices, square ones, oblong ones, circular ones, and robes and titles, especially the titles of doctor given to education degree holders in state colleges who address each other as doctor. They should respect all dogs, love one breed intensely, eat fruit, eat root vegetables, read Lear endlessly, and be suspicious of Gertrude Stein, with the exception of her war plays. They should love New York, know how two foreign languages, practice both regret and remorse, love their own cities, forgive but not forget, live in at least three countries, work at a gas station, lift boxes, eat pears, learn a trade, respect pitch pines, believe in the soul. They should stop throwing rubbish out of the window. They should sit on park benches, marry young, marry late, love seals, love cows, talk to apes, weep for Tigrons, cheer on the carp, encourage the salmon and the shad, and read 20 books a year. They should talk to their neighbors and eat herring and boiled potatoes. This, at this point in my life, is a poem. We all, many of us, I guess, have one. That for some odd reason I can't explain, I return to over and over again. I've framed four copies now and will give them to my son or anyone I can bend an eye to spend some time reading it, looking at it, and so I wanted to share it with you this evening in my attempt to set the stage for us tonight. Next, I'd like to introduce... Jenny Browne's going to take us through the rest of this evening. She's the author of three collections of poems, At Once, The Second Reason, and Dear Stranger. A former James Mishner Fellow at the University of Texas, she worked for many years as a poet in the schools through the Texas Commission of the Arts before joining the English Department faculty at Trinity, where she teaches courses in creative writing, women and gender studies, and environmental literature. Her poems and essays have appeared widely, including American Poetry Review, Garden and Gun, The New York Times, and Tin House. She is the 2016 through 18 Poet Laureate for the City of San Antonio, lives in a 100-year-old house in the Lavaca neighborhood with her. There's a name I do know, I'm not having to turn the page. With her husband, photographer Scott Martin, and their daughters, Lydia and Harriet, and I'm proud to call her my friend. Jenny?
Acknowledge we have what I think the poet William Stafford would call a happy problem, and that is the fact that we have two rooms. And just before we enter into the part of the program where some really great people who are actually only volunteers in the sense that we're not paying them, I don't think anyone volunteered. Tom and I twisted a few arms and cajoled a few friends and called in a few favors, so I just want to thank them for being here. But before we start, if anyone's really having trouble hearing, if it would help to move a little closer, or I just want to check in before we start here. Are we all okay? I'm nobody. Who are you? Are you nobody too? Then there's a pair of us. Don't tell. They advertise, you know. How dreary to be somebody. How public, like a frog. To live your life, to tell one's name the livelong day, to an admiring bog. I almost knew it. I thought it'd be good to start with a moment of Emily Dickinson, who is a poet who matters immensely to me, because I think, as someone who lived most of her life in isolation, only publishing maybe 12 of the 1,800 some poems she wrote, to become a voice that so many turn to in this time, I think it speaks to the real power and reality of poetry being something that is really intimate and collective. And I think that's kind of what we wanted to honor tonight. Part of why I'm here is because the development office thought it'd be kind of cool. It's National Poetry Month, you're at Trinity, you're also the City Poet Laureate, come talk about poetry. And that's great, and it's cool, and all of that, but I've been talking about poetry a lot, and one of the things that I tell my students is, a poem shouldn't describe an experience, it should create one for a listener. And as I thought about it, I thought it'd be a lot more interesting to ask a few people who aren't poets as their job or something like that to just share a few words and a poem that means something to them, that is a part of their life for whatever reason. So that's what we're gonna do tonight. And it was funny, when I asked people, they're like, I don't know. Some of these people are poets, and I asked them to read a poem by someone else, and I think they welcomed that opportunity. It was funny, I just quoted William Stafford, and I'm fond of a little bit of an interview with him. Someone asked him, when did you first realize you wanted to become a poet? And he said, I thought about that, and I sort of reversed it. My question is, when did other people give up the idea of being a poet? So that was a good question. So I'm really thrilled to introduce our first reader tonight, my dear friend, neighbor, mentor, Trinity, 1974 Trinity graduate, who really just wants to talk to you about her first grandson, Connor, who is perfect, but instead she's going to read you a poem.
Hi. Good evening, everybody. This is a really fun and tasty evening. Thank you for inviting me. I'm very proud of Jenny Browne, very proud of Trinity University Press and all the wonderful books they do, Tom and Barbara, and I'm very proud to be a Trinity graduate. I've visited countless campuses since I graduated so long ago, and I think Trinity is really one of the most wholehearted, beautiful, wonderful campuses anybody could ever have the privilege of having been part of. So thank you for letting me be part tonight. My entire life was determined next to the old mailboxes in Northrop Hall when Robert Flynn came by and said to me in 1974, a month before I graduated, have you ever thought about just visiting schools and talking about poetry? And I said, well, how does somebody do that? And so he sent me on my way. I was already a fan of William Stafford, and William Stafford was probably the poet I have used the most in schools over the past many, many years. So this is from a book called The Way It Is, New and Selected Poems. Oh, thanks. This is called Vocation, for all of your many vocations. This dream, the world is having about itself, includes a trace on the plains of the Oregon Trail, a groove in the grass my father showed us all one day while meadowlarks were trying to tell something better about to happen. I dreamed the trace to the mountains, over the hills, and there a girl who belonged wherever she was. But then my mother called us back to the car. She was afraid. She always blamed the place, the time, anything my father planned. Now both of my parents, the long line through the plain, the meadowlarks, the sky, the world's whole dream remain. And I hear him say, while I stand between the two, helpless, both of them part of me, your job is to find what the world is trying to be.
Our next reader is Becca McNeil. She is a native San Antonian and a Trinity alum who went and lived a bunch of places, Los Angeles and London, before coming back. She writes about education for the Rivard Report and actually lives next door to Trinity with her husband, Lewis, and they let their children, Mara and Asa, 8 months old, run wild on campus. Please invite Becca.
Hi, everyone. So as Jenny mentioned, I'm an education writer, and the legislature is in session, so my life right now is anything but poetry. It is a lot of jargon and a lot of, I said earlier, if we were having a favorite bill reading, I could just own this. But poetry. Over my kind of lifelong love affair with words, poetry has always been actually the hardest for me to access, and I really only find my way back to it again and again in times of longing. I found that it was in times of great homesickness or in times of lovesickness, I would find that I could only write poetry and I could only relate to poetry to express those deep, deep longings. And the first poet who I felt like really satisfied that was Pablo Neruda. And I know that he has done that for many, many people. And it was, I was my senior year in high school, and it was a really conservative evangelical Christian school. I don't know what they were doing letting us read Pablo Neruda, but they did, and I'm so happy that they did, because when I heard, when we read it out loud, I thought, that's how I want to be loved. And it was one of his sonnets. And time went by, and at some point I met Lewis, and I was away on for business on work at work, and I found that my feeling of homesickness and my feeling of lovesickness were for the same person. And I know, we're very, very cute that way. But anyway, he must have been feeling the same way too, because about an hour after I got off the plane, he asked me to marry him. I said yes. And once again that summer, it was Pablo Neruda. He was the only one who could really express what I was feeling. So, without further ado. Also, I had to promise Lewis I wouldn't read this in Spanish and embarrass myself. Of all the stars I admired, drenched in various rivers and mists, I chose only the one I love. Since then, I sleep with the night. Of all the waves, one wave and another wave, green sea, green chill, branchings of green, I chose only the one wave, the indivisible wave of your body. All the water drops, all the roots, all the threads of life gathered to me here, they came to me sooner or later. I wanted your hair all for myself. From all the graces my homeland offered, I chose only your savage heart.
Chair of the Department of Computer Science at Trinity currently, which means his publications often have titles like A Content Functional Approach to Intelligence in Robotic Systems. But we actually see a lot of him in the English department, and I was getting ready to introduce him today. I ran into one of my colleagues and I said, "Tell me about Paul." And she said, "Well, he's taken enough of my classes, including Brit Lit Survey, Romantic Poetry, Victorian Poetry, Lyric Form, John Austin, John Keats, and several others, that we should make him an English major." This is my colleague Betsy Tantefoffel. And my other colleague David Rando said, "He's actually taken so many of my classes he could probably teach them." And occasionally they fight over which of their classes Paul is going to register for. And both said his endless curiosity and enthusiasm make him the ideal student.
I guess this doesn't clip on, because I have to use two hands. Okay, well, I'll just start. "One rapero with his shura sota, the draught of March hath pierced to the rota and bathed every vein in sweet liqueur." Maybe I won't continue with the prologue of Canterbury Tales. I had to memorize that in high school, thinking that one day it might actually come in useful. And it does have the word April in it, so it's kind of homage to this month. I think, to get more serious, I'd really like to thank Jenny. I was just bowled over when she asked me to do this. I mean, yeah, we know each other, and yeah, I have this love of literature, but I don't create literature, and I take the classes. I don't even write the term papers. So I was just bowled over, and I really appreciate that you would include me with such an amazing program of people. I guess when my life of the mind started as a teenager, I guess, it kind of, the seminal moments was starting to read Saturday Review, for some of you who may remember that. It was a wonderful, wonderful magazine, and I kept subscriptions to it for the longest time. And back in 1977, they, you know, I guess it's filler, they had one page with two poems by Robert Penn Warren. Well, I'd heard of Robert Penn Warren, but I, like other people have said, poetry really had not done much for me. You know, I'd studied in high school and all, but it was just too difficult and just didn't speak to me in the ways that I wished it would. But I read these two poems, and boy, did they speak to me. I would say these two poems were the beginning of my interest in poetry. They're by Robert Penn Warren, who also, and I'm happy to say, was the first poet laureate of the United States. So this kind of plays on Jenny's position right now. The two poems were one called Code Book Lost, and I've used that many, many times in a first year seminar that I taught at Trinity for many, many times. In fact, the title of the seminar was Code Book Lost. It's kind of a poem about the significance behind things, behind ordinary reality. Had a lot of appeal to me. And I thought about reading that, but in a way it's a little kind of too didactic or something, and this is not a class. So the accompanying poem was a poem that I think just has a little more mystery to it or something. It's a poem I really love, but I've never used it in any way. It's called Boy Wandering in Simms's Valley by Robert Penn Warren. Through brush and love vine, well blooded by blackberry thorn, long dry past prime, all under the molten light of late summer, and past the last rock slide at ridgetop and stubborn raw tangle of cedar, I clambered, breath short and spit white from lung depth. Then down the lone valley called Simms's Valley still, where Simms for long years had nursed a sick wife till she died. Then turned out his spindly stock to forage at will, and took down his 12 gauge and simply lay down by her side. No kin they had, and nobody came just to jaw. It was 2 years before some straggling hunter sat down on the porch edge to rest, then started to prowl. He saw what he saw no reason to linger, so hightailed to town. A dirt farmer needs a good wife to keep a place trim, so the place must have gone to rack with his old lady sick. And when I came there years later, old furrows were dim, and dimmer in the fields where grew maples and such a span thick. So for years the farm had contracted, now barn down, and all the yard back to wilderness gone, and only the house to mark human hope, and that ready to fall. No buyer at tax sale, it waited, forgotten and lonely. I stood in the bedroom upstairs in lowering sun, and saw sheets hang spiderweb rotten, and blankets a mass of what weather and leaves from the broken window had done, not to mention the rats, and thought, what had there come to pass? But lower was sinking the sun. I shook myself, flung a last glance round, then suddenly saw the old enameled bedpan high on a shelf. I stood still again as the last sun fell on me. Excuse me. And stood wondering what life is and love and what they may be.
Poetry for a living, especially at a place like Trinity, is you get a lot of students who don't necessarily want to be poets, including often, you know, these computer geeks whose brains just work in really interesting ways. And I like to think Dirk Elmendorf would have been one of those students. He graduated, I mean, geek in like as the highest term of like regard, just to be clear.
We're winning, so
he graduated with a degree, you are winning, with a degree in economics in 1997. And after helping to start a very small computer consulting company, stumbled onto the idea that would change his life. You've heard of this little company called Rackspace that went public this year for, you know, $4.5 billion. But he had left Rackspace and got back to his startup roots in 2009 and continues to run a local consultancy company called R26D, focused on innovation, and is active in promoting math, science, and technology education through the 80-20 Foundation in the Woody Museum. Please welcome Dirk.
Geek is certainly no longer pejorative.
It is not pejorative.
I'm on board with that. Okay, so they said pick a poem that was important, and I had to think through. Actually, I was surprised at a long list. But we'll go back to the 20th century, 1989, before phones, maybe. Certainly the internet as we knew it. I grew up in a small farm town outside Indianapolis called Brownsburg, population 6,000. And in 1989, I was transferring from our single public junior high to a private college preparatory school in Indianapolis, Brebeuf Jesuit. And I started there fairly intimidated, worried about how far behind I was. In my first English class, I had one of those teachers that I swear Dead Poets Society was based on. This guy was crazy. Earth Day, he had a toilet out front with a globe in it complaining at us about we weren't taking care of things. And he made us memorize poems, and that is exactly what this poem is. This is the first poem I ever had to memorize. And unlike the beginning of Canterbury Tales, I will tell you there's a stanza in this poem that there have been many, many times in my career when I have thought about making one pile and what's going to happen. So, it is If by Rudyard Kipling. If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, and if you can wait and not be tired by waiting, or being lied about, but don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good, nor talk too wise, if you can dream and not drink dreams your master, if you can think and not make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with triumph and disaster, and treat those two imposters as the same. If you can bear to hear the truth you've spoken, twisted by knaves to make a trap for fools, or watch the things you gave your life to broken, and stoop and build them up with worn out tools. If you can make one heap of all your winnings, and risk it on one turn of pitch and toss, and lose and start again at your beginnings, and never breathe a word about your loss. If you can force your heart and nerve and sinew to serve your turn long after they are gone, and so hold on when there is nothing in you except the will which says to them, hold on. If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings and never lose that common touch, if neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you, but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it, and once more, you'll be a man, my son. Thank you.
About Colleen Grissom that hasn't been said. She is in fact the senior member of our faculty, having served Trinity University since 1958. And she started, she began as an instructor in English and head resident, left for 2 years to finish her coursework at UT for her PhD, but couldn't resist Jim Lahrie's salary offer of $6,000 annually to return as she wrote her dissertation. And she's been there ever since. She also served as the, let me get this right, the Vice President for Student Affairs and the Dean of Students, but since 2000 has been full-time professor of English. We love her. She wrote a book called A Novel Approach to Life, and Trinity University Press published that, as well as the book with my favorite title ever, ever, The World According to Colleen. Yes.
Rob is clapping because she named that.
Did you? Is it your title?
Hello. Before we get started, could somebody send a double bourbon to the kid that's screaming in the other room? I, too. Talk among yourselves. See, I told you. I hear him. I cover the walls of my home as well as the walls of my office with items that I love that I've had framed. Most important of all those is what I would call a portrait gallery of memorabilia from my idol, my role model, the divine Miss M, Bette Midler. This includes a letter which Ms. Midler once sent to me in which she says, I am also a PhD, pretty hot and divine. Most recently, a friend, as a birthday gift to me, framed a Gerald Stern, I believe, statement that was a cherished presentation to me and others from the Trinity University Press in celebration of Stern's steel history. But I also glance frequently at the walls in my home and in my office, at framed views of the Santa Fe sky, photos of my younger, more slender, but with the same haircut self, with staring guests who came to Trinity. There I am with John Updike, Louis Erdrich, Susan Sontag, drinking tequila straight up, Susan Sontag, not I, Saul Bellow, Joyce Carol Oates, Kurt Vonnegut, Margaret Atwood. I also have a few frames displayed on my wall that contain poems that I have loved. I have two by the late Mae Sarton, and another from Joyce Carol Oates that she wrote when she was visiting Trinity and dedicated it to me. It's in one of her collections. You can find it and prove it for yourself. It's entitled, the name of the collection is Time Traveler. You can find it. The poem she dedicated to me, I'm sorry to say, has the bizarre title, Don't Bear Your Soul. As if I ever in hell would. But I digress. Another of the framed items in my home is the poem I will read for this occasion. I selected it to read because I love the poet and I love the feline species. The poet is Margaret Atwood. The center of the poem is a cat whose name is Blackie. The poem is entitled Blackie in Antarctica. It's from Atwood's 2007 collection, The Door. Now we'll try to read the poem. What lighting, what ease to do this. I want you to stay here and hold the microphone. You know I can do it. I'm facing this way for a minute. My sister phones long distance. Blackie's been put down. Incurable illness, gauntness and suffering. General heartbreak. I thought you'd want to bury him, she says, in tears. So I wrapped him in red silk and put it in the freezer. We're going to set stanza two. This is fun. There's no way to do this. I'm doing it. But I'm writing you a note tomorrow that you'll remember. Old Blackie, named bluntly and without artifice by small girls, black cat leaping from roof to roof in doll's bonnet and pinafore, with sly, fur-faced idol who endured worship and mauling, often without scratching, old yowling moon addict, devious foundling, neurotic astrologer who predicted disaster by then creating it. Oh, midnight-colored, faithful companion of midnight. Oh, pillow hog with your breath of raw liver. Where are you now? Yes. This is fun. Beside the frozen hamburger and chicken wings, a paradise for carnivores, lying in red silk and state like Pharaoh on a white metallic temple, or a thin-boned Antarctic explorer in gelid parka, one who didn't make it. Or, let's face it, a package of fish. I hope nobody en route to dinner unwraps you by mistake. What an affront to be equated with meat. Cat-like, you hated being ridiculous. You hungered for justice at set hours and in the form of sliced beef stewed with gravy. You wanted what was coming to you. Death is, though, ridiculous and coming to you. For us too, justice is what we'll turn into. Then there's mercy.
No one said Kelly Grissom suffered fools. I'm fond of grand pronouncements in class, you know, like things like every poem is a love poem, or every poem is about time, and I don't know if I believe them or not, but I do believe the love poem part, because I think if you pay close enough attention to something to write a poem about it, it's a kind of love. And because I am both a hopeless romantic and a terrible matchmaker, if I ever try, it never works out. I'm so thrilled to read you this brief bio of our next readers who are going to read as a couple. Jenna Price, Dan Mallett and Jenna Price Mallett both moved to San Antonio to attend Trinity University and met in 2011 during their first semester of their senior year in Jenny Browne's poetry class. Bonding over coffee, pecans, poetry, and a penchant for thoughtful and critical feedback, which I think is good for marriage, the two became friends and co-conspirators. But fast forward to second semester and the long poem class. Dan and Jenna started dating, and lucky for us, in 2014, were married and have chosen to make San Antonio their home. Dan's a teacher at the SAIC's new Advanced Learning Academy, and Jenna is the director for development for the Rebard Report. Please welcome them up here. I said they had to read together. I don't know how to manage, just do your best.
All right, we will try our best to share the microphone. I will probably hog it more than Dan, so we'll try to share. But, so we picked a poem by Dorianne Lowe, and as we were kind of choosing what poem to read, as Jenny said, you know, there was a lot of discussion in poetry class about every poem being a love poem, and when she asked us to read, it was, we were like, we're not picking a love poem. That's not gonna be what we pick. But we did, you know, the poem that we picked is Facts About the Moon, and it means a lot to us and for a lot of reasons, but you know, when you're kind of examining the type of poet you are and imagining, I don't know if Dan, you want to explain the sun versus moon poet?
Sure. So we're early in like that first semester, I think Jenny Browne came to class and she said, there's two kinds of poets, there's either sun poets or moon poets, and I think both of us just sort of like head up, like almost like a bell struck inside of us, and we were like, moon poets. Like, there's no, like, I don't know, it's like one of those weird things, you know what I mean? It just sort of like made sense, and it was like, boom, you know? It made sense. I was like, sun poet, I have no idea what that means, but moon poet, like, it just, I don't know. So, I think if you want to talk about that, or just...
Yeah, so we, Facts About the Moon is a poem that we read during, actually, I think during our long poem class, and it was shortly after we discussed being sun or moon poets, so that's the poem we want to share with y'all today.
Facts About the Moon by Dorianne Lowe. The moon is backing away from us an inch and a half each year. That means if you're like me and were born around 50 years ago, the moon was a full 6 feet closer to the earth. What's a person to do? I feel the gray cloud of consternation travel across my face.
I begin thinking about the moonlit past, how if you go back far enough, you can imagine the breathtaking hugeness of the moon. Prehistoric solar eclipses when the moon covered the sun so completely there was no corona, only a darkness that we had no word for.
In future, eclipses will look like this. The moon, a small black pupil in the eye of the sun, but these are bald facts.
What bothers me most is that someday the moon will spiral right out of orbit and all land-based life will die.
The moon keeps the oceans from swallowing the shores, keeps the electromagnetic fields in check at the polar ends of the earth, and please don't tell me what I already know. that it won't happen for a long time. I don't care. I'm afraid of what will happen to the moon.
Forget us. We don't deserve the moon. Maybe we once did, but not now, after all we've done. These nights I harbor a secret pity for the moon, rolling around alone in space without her milky planet, her only love, a mother who's lost a child, a bad child, a greedy child, or maybe a grown boy who's murdered and raped, a mother who can't help it. She loves that boy anyway, and in spite of herself, she misses him. And if you sit beside her on the padded hospital bench outside the door to his room, you can't not take her hand. Listen to her while she weeps, telling you how sweet he was, how blue his eyes, and you know she's only romanticizing, that she's conveniently forgotten the bruises and booze, the stolen car, the day he ripped the phones from the walls, and you want to slap her back to sanity, remind her of the truth.
He was a leech, a fuck-up, a little shit, and you almost do until she lifts her pale, puffy face, her eyes to craters, and then you can't help it either. You know love when you see it. You can feel its lunar strength, its brutal pull.
I don't get to see them enough. I say all kinds of things in class that I don't ever remember saying, and there's this unfortunate way people write them down. I was feeling a little bit intimidated tonight about how to introduce Arturo Madrid, because I was thinking about it, and I was thinking about, he's recently retired from Trinity as the Noreen R. and T. Frank Murchison Distinguished Professor of the Humanities. But what I was thinking about even more importantly than that is, now at a time when I think the word diversity has been watered down so much to become a marketing term at best, and at worst often is what white people say when we don't want to talk about race and how far we still have to go in this country, I felt like what I needed to note was the lifelong work of Dr. Madrid to develop authentic inclusion of and discourse about Latinos in American society by developing organizations, research centers, and really entire fields of study. He has founded, directed, or served on the boards of numerous national organizations, including the Tomas Rivera Center, the Fund for the Improvement of Postsecondary Education, and the National Center for Public Policy and Higher Education. His honors include the Charles Frankel Award from the National Endowment for the Humanities, the John Hope Franklin Award, and honorary degrees from Mount Holyoke College and Pomona College. I get to see him often because we work out at the Y together. And he is also the author of In the Country of Empty Crosses, the story of a Hispano-Protestant family in Catholic Mexico, which was published by Trinity University Press in 2012. Please welcome Dr. Madrid.
Are you going to be able to do this?
I was wondering if I was going to be able to see. It looks like I'm going to be able to see.
Okay,
and I may have somebody hold this thing for me.
You're pretty large.
I think I'm fine. I think I'm fine.
Hold it.
If you would, yeah. I ran into Jenny last week. I was very apologetic because I had not responded, and I was going to say, you know, I'm just going to have gotten off a plane, and I shouldn't. But she said, but I want somebody that reads something different, particularly something that maybe mixes two languages. And that booked me, so here I am this evening. The poem I'm going to read is by a man by the name of Jose Montoya, que en paz descanse. He passed away recently. He was our friend. My compañera Antonia Castaneda and I attended a memorial service for him. We admired him enormously. Quite well, particularly she did. He was one of the founders of a poetry and art organization called the Royal Chicano Art Front. Subsequently became the Royal Chicano Air Force because they flew Adobe airplanes. He was a wonderful sense of humor, wonderful writer, wonderful artist. And so that the Chicano movement is important here because it was a moment when the Mexican-American population affirmed its place in American society. It formed, affirmed its cultural experience. It sought also to affirm working class expression, a working class consciousness, and not apologize for. What you're going to hear tonight is an elegy. It's you've already figured that out, probably. It's a very unusual kind of elegy. Poetry, as you know, those of us who read and love poetry know, understand that it is infused with reference, some explicit, mostly implicit. We like to figure them out. In this particular case, there are any number of references that, if you had time, you would go figure them out. But you don't have time, so I prepared a cheat sheet for you so that you can follow along. At any rate, it's been a pleasure to be at Trinity University for that many years. I lay claim to having helped bring our dear friend Barbara Ross to Trinity University and have gloried in all the things that she's done, and I'm pleased that Tom will continue them. So let me now turn to this with Jenny's help. El Louis. Hoy enterraron a Louis. En San Pedro, or San Pinche, are in for it. And those days, those times of the 40s and the early 50s, lost un vato ghetto. Kind of slim and drawn there toward the end, aging fast from too much booze y la vida dura, a class to the end. In San Juan, you'd see him sporting the dark top cap, top coat, playing in his fantasy the role of Bogart, Cagney, or Raft. Era del Fowler el vato, canal del Candy y el Ponchi, los Rodriguez, the West Side Moon, and Selma, even Gilroy. 48 Fleet Line, two-tone, buenas garras, and always rucas, como la Mary y la Helen. Siempre con liras bien afinadas, cantando la palma. La cantaba en el florero. Louis hit on the idea in those days for tailor-made drapes. Unique idea, porque Fowler no era nada como los o el EPT. Fresno's West Side was as close as we ever got to the big time. But we had Louis and the Palomar, el Boogie, los Mambos, y cuatro suspiros del alma. Y nunca faltaba that gut-shrinking, love-splitting, asshole uptight bad news. Trucha esos, va a haber pedo. Abusado ese, get Louis. No llores, Carmen, we can handle him. Ese, un tal Jimmy. Órale, Louis, first primo. Va a haber casos in the parking lot, away from the jura. Órale, tres filero. Simón, el chal ese. Este vato. And Louis would come through. Melodramatic music, like in the mono. Tan, tan, taran, Cruz Diablo, el charro negro. Bogart's smile, that smile as deadly as his vices. He dug roles, man, and names, like Black, Lil Louis. Ese Louis, chale, call me Diamonds, man. Y en Korea, fue soldado de levita, con huevos, and all the paradoxes del soldado raso, heroism and the sarcasm. And on leave, jump boots, chinadas, and ribbons, cocky from the war, strutting to early mass on Sunday morning. Wow, is that a Louis? Mire, comadre, ahí va el hijo de Lola. Afterward, he and Fat Richard would hawk their bronze stars for pisto in el Jardín Canales y en el Trocadero. At Barber College, he came out with honors. Después, empeñaba su velado en la peluca para jugar poca cerrada en Lobao, en Sanjo, en Alviso. Legs, Louis Dine, hit out some lean. Hoy enterraron a Louis. In Fowler, at Missy's, Pool Parlor, los Baby Chooks, ¿se acuerdan de Louis? El carnal del Candy y el Ponche, la vez que lo filiaron en la casa Don y cuando se casó, se cambió con la chiva. Hoy enterraron a Luis. His death was an insult, porque no murió en acción. No lo mataron los guatos ni los gooks en Korea. He died alone in a rented room, perhaps like in a Bogart movie. The end was a cruel hoax, but his life had been remarkable. Marco Giatole e Luis Torre.
Wowed by the range. I didn't ask anyone what they were going to read, which maybe was a little bit of a dare, but I didn't want to. So I've loved the surprises all around. So I just want to make sure I'm not skipping anything. With these bios, it's been interesting. I don't know Gretchen Rush, but I tried to sell her a car a while ago, and we were going back and forth about this car, and she said, "You know, I always wanted to take a poetry class." And I said, "Well, I always wanted to be a professional athlete." And I kind of thought, you know, there are some dreams you leave behind and there are some that leave you. And she is the Trinity University tennis coach at Trinity. She's a four-time All-American, an Olympian, played on the women's professional tennis circuit. I could go on and on. She sent me her bio at the last minute right before practice this afternoon, and I wrote her back and I said, "I was just going to say you were a badass." And she said, "Okay, go ahead." So this is Gretchen Rush. Do you need my mic? Here, give it a shot.
I need all the props.
Okay, I got you.
First of all, I did not buy the car off Tiger Talk. It's the third car I've looked on Tiger Talk. If you want to sell anything, put it on Tiger Talk. Thrilled to be here, as many of the readers have said. I am a lover of words. Can y'all hear me? I ditched you guys. I'm a lover of words. I mess up my words. I try to talk to my tennis team and they don't understand me. I've tried so hard to get my words to match what's inside my head. So you know what they were? We figured out the words.
Okay, is that okay? Stay down here.
And I am embarrassed to say that I am going to read one of Naomi's poems. And I did not know how to say your name before the night started. I vaguely knew you went to Trinity. I just figured out later in life that poetry is basically music, which I've been singing my whole life without the accompaniment. This book was given to me by one of my tennis students. I was a tennis teacher while I was raising my children, and I read and played music and listened to music, but I didn't understand poetry. I didn't get it. One of my tennis students gave me this book. It's called Saved by a Poem. It's by Kim Rosen. Has anybody seen it or read it? Kim Rosen? Naomi, you know this book. Kim basically struggled in her life, and poetry saved her. As a child, it saved her. And I went through a very difficult time in my life, raising my children, just very midlife crisis kind of stuff, nothing unusual. But this book was given to me at a perfect time in my life. And it was just telling me that sometimes poems can say the words you're feeling, but you don't even know what you're feeling, but a poem, somebody else figured it out and wrote it down for you. And I'm going to read Naomi's poem, and I'm grateful to see you. This poem has meant very, very much to me, and it also saved Kim's life in a way, and it saved my life in the words that it gave words to what I was feeling, and it gave me direction of where I wanted to go with my life when I didn't know where to go. And I find it very ironic that I'm sitting at a table of groups of Trinitonians. I feel like life gave me a redo. I got a restart. I'm back here after 35 years, and I'm reading Kindness, written by Naomi Shihab Nye, here at Trinity, with my Trinity family. family. So the book, the title is called Kindness. Before you know what kindness really is, you must lose things. Feel the future dissolve in a moment, like salt in a weakened broth. What you held in your hand, what you counted and carefully saved, all this must go, so you know how desolate the landscape can be between the regions of kindness. How you ride and ride, thinking the bus will never stop. The passengers eating maize and chicken will stare out the window forever. Before you learn the tender gravity of kindness, you must travel where the Indian in a white poncho lies dead by the side of the road. You must see how this could be you. How he too was someone who journeyed through the night with plans and the simple breath that kept him alive. Before you know kindness as the deepest thing inside, you must know sorrow as the other deepest thing. You must wake up with sorrow. You must speak it till your voice catches the thread of all the sorrows and you see the size of the cloth. Then it is only kindness that makes sense anymore. Only kindness that ties your shoes and sends you out into the day to mail letters and purchase bread. Only kindness that raises its head from the crowd of the world to say, it is I you have been looking for. And then you go, and then it goes with you everywhere like a shadow in a friend. So I thank you all for being my Trinity friends. I thank you, Naomi, for writing this poem. And I thank you, Jenny. I actually never met her. I met her beautiful family. She was out of town. If I wouldn't have looked at her father-in-law's car, I certainly would not be here tonight. Thank you all for listening to me speak. I am thrilled to be a part of the Trinity family again, and I thank you all for inspiring me tonight. Thank you.
I might have to write a poem about the kindness of the tennis coach not buying my car. Or something like that. That was beautiful, Gretchen. Thank you so much. Next reader is David Ribble, who is really a trifecta of the Trinity experience, an alum from, as he said, a long time ago, a professor of biology, and also a member of the TU Press Advisory Board. David teaches courses in ecology, evolution, and conservation biology, and his work has taken him all over the globe, including Costa Rica, South Africa, Mexico, and Tanzania. When he got here, I said, didn't you discover a rat? And that wasn't exactly right, but some of his research culminated in the description of the discovery and description of a brand new mammal called the gray-faced elephant shrew, but around Trinity, some call it the ribble rat. I've had the privilege of teaching with David in the High Lonesome Field School and in the first year experience on climate change. And one of the things he has said that has always moved me is you can have all the data in the world, but if you can't figure out how to communicate it, and I think this is certainly true about climate change, if you can't figure out a way to communicate that makes people think and ask questions and care, it's just data. And, you know, what he's really saying is that a lot of it is how you say it, which I think makes, or learning how to say, which makes him a poet. He might not agree, but I think he is. I've also made him write poems in class, which is a lot of fun.
Well, thank you, Jenny. And fortunately, you won't hear me read one of my poems. But I do think Jenny said something that, I mean, I think I've come to appreciate poetry as a scientist because much of my work is really descriptive science, which is, you know, maybe not getting the big bucks, maybe not in vogue, but it's so critically important in describing what we see, what we observe, and in nature as, you know, things are sadly falling apart. And so I think what has drawn me to poetry is the precision of the word choice and how important that is. And so I thank Jenny for the opportunity to teach with her and so forth. And so when I was asked to read a poem, I was reminded very quickly of my time working, it was my PhD in the Carmel Valley in California, which of course is Robinson Jeffers' territory, and his descriptions of places in those areas were very striking to me. But it also reminded me of his poetry was introduced to me by a good friend who I came across in the Carmel Valley, who was a photographer, and he would go with us out in the field. And this is what happens when you ask a scientist to get up and read a poem. But so I was studying mice in the wild, and these are mice that are only active at night, and these are mice that turns out they're monogamous, which monogamy is very rare among mammals, and I can tell you about that over a few drinks later. To study these nocturnal small animals was really quite tricky, and so one of the things we would do is we would dust mice with these fluorescent powders. Okay, I'm not making this up. And these colors then would show up on who they were mating with as well as their offspring. So we would actually trap these animals and we would look at them under black lights to look at these colors. And so my friend was out there photographing all this, and he had to give me this book of poetry. And so I am going to read a poem, but still I came across these words just this last week and I forgot about it. So the mouse was the California mouse. The scientific name was Paramiscus californicus, but Ian is the guy who gave me this book in January of 89, and he said, "May all your Paramiscus californicus fornicate and glow in monochromatic bliss." I should probably stop there, but anyway. I was impressed with Robinson Jeffers' choice of words and his places and descriptions, and so I chose a poem of his, oddly enough, called Animals. At dawn, a knot of sea lions lies off the shore in the slow swell between the rock and the cliff. Sharp flippers lifted, or great-eyed heads, as they roll in the sea, bigger than draft horses and barking like dogs, their all-night song. It makes me wonder a little that life near kin to human, intelligent, hot-blooded, idle and singing, can float at ease in the ice-cold midwinter water. Then yellow dawn colors the south. I think about the rapid and furious lives in the sun. They have little to do with ours. They have nothing to do with oxygen and salted water. They would look monstrous if we could see them. The beautiful, passionate bodies of living flame, bat-like flapping and screaming, tortured with burning lust and acute awareness that ride the storm tides of the great fire globe. They are animals as we are. There are many other chemistries of animal life besides the slow oxidation of carbohydrates and amino acids.
I couldn't resist.
It's a different kind of, thank you, David. Scientists and poetry classes have great vocabularies. And they also bust you if there's anything that's remotely, like, inaccurate. You know, you don't really call those below geographic plates, that are called something else. So anyway, they're useful for all kinds of things. It's a different kind of challenge to introduce someone who everyone in this whole town knows, but it is a thrill for me to introduce Judge Nelson Wolf. He has been our Texas State Representative, a member of the Texas Senate, a member of our City Council, and the Mayor of San Antonio from 1991 to 95. He was actually only the second person in more than a century to serve as both mayor of San Antonio and Bexar County judge. He is currently a Bexar County judge, a position he was appointed to in 2001 and has since been reelected four times. Judge Nelson Wolf is also an author of five books and a Trinity University Press author and an avid reader and collector of first editions. His most recent book, Bexar Bibliotech, The Evolution of the Country's First All-Digital Public Library, takes the reader on a 20-year journey from his involvement in the building of a 240,000 square foot public central library that opened in 1995 to the creation of a 4,000 square foot digital public library in 2013. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that libraries save lives. And I think there's no greater tribute than to continue to build those in our town. I get a little choked up saying this. So I'm thrilled that Judge Wolf is here and that he's going to share a poem with us.
Well, first of all, Jenny, congratulations for your award this year being recognized as a poet laureate. And there's not a better poet than one that has a good personality.
Oh.
You got it.
Thank you.
Glad to see Barbara Rouse here. By the way, she's written a pretty good book on poems herself. And I want to thank Tom Payton for inviting me tonight. I think it was the year 2010. I had the opportunity to go to Jacques Voisin's home. He had married, I think in 1980, Marguerite Lee Davenport, who was with Trinity University. And I went there because I'd asked him to come to Commissioner's Court because I wanted to give him the highest recognition that we had. Because you know, he's a famous author, famous historian, gone to decadence. And he couldn't come because of his age. He was 102 when I went to see him. And he was as bright as he ever was. One of the things he asked me, what are you reading? And I said, well, I'm reading a book on Eisenhower by Kordak. And he says, well, did he have anything in there about the time that when he left the military and became president of Columbia University? I said, no, he didn't. He says, well, you know, I hired him. Now, that's kind of a funny feeling to be sitting across from a guy from a book you read to something that happened 70 years ago. And he was right there playing a major role in the life of then became President Eisenhower. But there was another reason I went there. And I pulled out a quote that he made in 1954, almost 60 years ago when I pulled it out. And this is what he wrote. Whoever wants to know the heart and mind of America had better learn the rules and reality of the game of baseball. And of course, I'm a baseball guy. I'm still playing at this age. And I said, do you still believe that almost 60 years later? And he said, yes, I do. There's nothing better for a young man or a young lady today than to play a baseball game and learn the discipline and the rules of that game, and then for America to pay attention to a game where you're not out there trying to kill each other. And so that is America's game, but over three centuries now. Born here in America and grew up here in America. So obviously I have a great fondness for that. So when Tom called me, he said, well, you may want to pick a poem about baseball. And I said, well, you know, that fits right where I am. And so this poem is it's a dream, surrealistic. It's about a player named Ted Williams. Ted Williams was recognized as probably the best hitter in the game of baseball ever. Batted 406 in 1941, the last player to ever bat over 400. He had 500 and some odd home runs. And he was a hitter, a contact hitter. He very, very seldom struck out. And so this poem was written by Gregory Corso, who lived from 1930 to about 2001. He was a running mate of Ferengati, who knew like City Bookstore in San Francisco. I know every time you're there, you're sure to go there, because I do. And he ran around with Ginsberg and the guys that hung out at, and Burroughs that hung out at New City Light Bookstore and became famous. So he was a baseball guy. And so he wrote this poem, and I thought it was meaningful for various different ways, certainly. Because I love the game myself. And so it goes like this. I dream Ted Williams leaning at night against the Eiffel Tower weeping. It's hard for me to see this. He was in uniform and his bat lay at his feet, knotted and twiggy. Randall Jarrell says you're a poet. Randall Jarrell was a poet critic at the time. Says you're a poet. I cried. And so do I. I say you're a poet. He picked up his bat with blown hands, stood there astride as he would in a batter's box, and laughed, flinging his schoolboy rap. He was a real smart elf. Towards some invisible pitcher's mound, waiting to pitch all the way from heaven. It came. Hundreds came, all afire. He swung and swung and swung and connected not one. Sink or curve, hook or right down the middle. 100 strikes. The umpire dressed in a strange attire. Thundered his judgment, you're out. In the phantom crowd's horrific boo, dispersed the gargoyles from Notre Dame. Now, that had to be the devil throwing him those fire pitches. Had to be the handmaiden of the devil calling him out. Didn't come from heaven, I don't think. And I screamed in my dream, God, throw a merciful pitch. Herald the crack of bats. Hooray the sharp liner to left. Yay the double, the triple, Hosanna the home run. And I still look for that pitch from God every time I go to bat. Thank you.
About finished. One person who couldn't be here tonight, who was scheduled to be here, is Kerry Clack, the Longtime Express News columnist, and he sent in his poem, and he said, it would mean a lot to me if you read this tonight, and it's really short, by Langston Hughes, and it felt like a good way to end. I think what we've heard tonight is the way poems help our stories become visible to each other, the stories of our lives, the poems we love, our journeys. And this poem by Langston Hughes is called Aunt Sue's Stories. And Kerry said it reminded him of listening to his grandmother sitting on a porch on the east side of San Antonio. Aunt Sue has a head full of stories. Aunt Sue has a whole heart full of stories. Summer nights on the front porch, Aunt Sue cuddles a brown-faced child to her bosom and tells him stories. Black slaves working in the hot sun, and black slaves walking in the dewy night, and black slaves singing sorrow songs on the banks of a mighty river. Mingle themselves softly in the flow of old Aunt Sue's voice. Mingle themselves softly in the dark shadows that cross and recross Aunt Sue's stories. And the dark-faced child listening knows that Aunt Sue's stories are real stories. He knows that Aunt Sue never got her stories out of any book at all, but that they came right out of her own life. The dark-faced child is quiet on a summer night, listening to Aunt Sue's stories. I want to give just a huge hand of applause, a round of applause to these amazing people. And I want to thank the development office. Real quickly, we have two small gifts. Trinity University Press has donated a broadside of Gerald Stern's that you heard some of his poems tonight. I think Susan has picked a name. Who is our lucky winner?
Jeannie Browning has won
the Gerald Stern broadside. And I also want to say there is a really excellent party favor. You'll see these beautiful blue books on this banquet thing out here. As you go out, please take one. They look like this. And they're actually a part of a collaborative poetry project where people wrote these poems together. It's a brilliant, interesting book, and it's beautiful that Trinity Press made it. And thank you again for joining us tonight. This was just a blast.